But I want to talk about cognition, because I just talked about how the changes in the synaptic level. Now, we talk about cognitive process. Everybody's interested in cognition. I think we can view cognition in three levels. Normally we have a cognition about outside world, right? Our sensation, information flow, sensation, well, motor action, so it depends on our perception of the outside world. Now this includes sensation, perception, attention to a particular part of the information, decision making, concept forming about the outside world. Now this is that's a desk of the same category, a forming a concept of desk and a categorization of different type of animal. Now dogs are dogs even though they're different species. These are concept and categorization, cognition about outside world. Many animals have this. So when you talk about animal models, you can study this in animals. Even fruit fly have a sophisticated cognitive process. Honeybees have a good cognitive process. So you can study a lot of cognition at this level. But they are all more interesting because we're understanding our brain, right? So there's a cognition about self and non-self. That's more complicated. I know I'm here standing, I know you are listening. I have to have the concept of myself and you, other people. And these concepts, self-awareness, and the sympathy and empathy, empathy, tonglixin, I know what you're thinking about. I have the same thinking, empathy. Theory of mind, I know what you're thinking. A theory about your mind, not my own mind. The theory of mind, all this are the important aspect of concept of self and non-self. Now, who has it? Non-human primate may have some. Some of the non-human primate may be a model system for you, but below primate, there's no model for this so far. Right? So you can study self and non-self. This is very important because this is an important transition to a human-specific function of language. Because for language to be recognized, you need to have cognition of self and non-self. Like, you know, I'm talking to you, I know you are talking to me. So without self and non-self cognition, you cannot have language. Right? So language ability is only human because only human can acquire language with syntax and grammar and has an open-ended construction of your sentence. And who has it? No animal has it. Chimps, you can train chimps for years. In years, they can recognize symbols but not language. They cannot form sentences. That's complicated. So, is non-human primate still can serve as a model for it? In order to understand a language, I know this is a Professor Wong. We have more to say on this, but the origin of language, in my mind, you got to go to earlier. You have to have an animal model, you want to make the circuits, you want to manipulate and see how the ability of forming the language ability appear in the circuits. So it's possible that proto-language, some form of rudimentary language might be able to, you can use primary model where you introduce genes of human genes into monkey and that allows you better sound production, better motor coordination of your face and your tongue, right? All this can may help you produce language. Now, obviously, there could be some genes that allow the circuits that's required for monkey to acquire. So this, our neuroscience in the entire world are still mostly on this early part. Sensation, perception, even attention and decision making are much less understood. So we are really at a very, very beginning of understanding of cognition. So people talk about cognitive science is the very future, and we have a long way to go. And I think that we eventually need to go to that end, but there's a lot of work to do. And future generation, if you go into neuroscience, you have a job guarantee for century, as long as you can live. Now, I want to do, can I have five more?